welcome. I'm Martina Lucic.
And I'm Jamie Stangroom.
And this is the Road to Paris 2024, taking us all the way to the Olympic this summer in the French capital.
Oh yeah, and each episode sees us making a pit stop to talk about a different shooting sport Olympic discipline. But don't worry, it's not just Martina and me talking. We'll also be bringing you interviews with some of the biggest athletes from the sport.
Yes, we do. And if you don't believe us, in this episode, we've got an interview with the world champions Danka Bartekova of Slovakia, and we'll be hearing from three-time Olympic champion Kim Rhode.
Which can mean only one thing. We are riding a shotgun because it's the turn of the Skeet women's event. So, Martina, we're getting our Skeet on, but how does it work?
Well, as you said, in this episode, we'll cover the dynamic shooting sport event, the Skeet women's discipline. The root of Skeet shooting trails back to the early 20th century. Up until the 2000 Olympic Games, men and women competed together. But at the Sydney Games, the Skeet women Olympic event was born. In this discipline, competitors wield a 12-gauge shotgun and aim at clay targets released from two houses situated at either end of the shooting field. In qualification, athletes stand on 8 shooting stations, forming a semicircle in a designated field, shooting a total of 125 targets. They shoot down single and or double targets before moving to the next station. Speed, accuracy, and adaptability are crucial as shooters pivot from one target to the other. The athletes call for the targets by uttering "pull" before the target is released, signaling their readiness to shoot. The top performance advance to the final rounds, where they shoot additional 60 targets, only from 3 stations this time. Depending on the station, the athletes shoot down 1 or 2 doubles, meaning they always call for 2 targets at the same time. The 6 finalists engage in an elimination process after shooting 20 targets, and this process continues after every 10 targets until only 2 competitors remain to compete for the gold medal. In case of a tie for the top spot on the podium, the final 2 athletes go into a shoot-off, where they shoot 1 double at a time until the tie is broken. Today, skeet shooting stands as a popular and riveting sport, showcasing a remarkable athletes who exhibit exceptional focus and precision as they skillfully shoot down moving targets, making it a thrilling spectacle for everyone involved.
Thank you very much, Martina. So that's how it works, but who should we be looking out for at the Paris Games?
Well, I would say everybody that we have in this episode and more. If you have watched any of the World Cups, you would have at least a bit of an idea who we could find in the finals of the Olympics.
Yeah, we do have a couple of the big hitters appearing in this episode in just a few moments. But also, it's a big year for skeet as an event at the Olympics, isn't it?
Absolutely. The skeet mixed team is introduced, but we'll get to that episode a little bit later down the road.
Yeah, because of course at the Tokyo Games, 3 years ago now, it was Trap's turn to get the mixed team treatment, but it will be skeet in Paris. And as Martina mentioned, we will have a special episode dedicated to that coming up later in the series. Should we get into our first interview?
I think we're ready.
All right. Well, I say interview. There's a little bit of a caveat to that. Kimberly Rhode. I think it's fair to say she is the greatest female Olympian that shooting sport has ever produced. A 6-time Olympic medalist, 3-time Olympic champion, and she's looking to make Paris her 7th Games. And then Los Angeles 2028, her hometown, her 8th Games. She's shown no signs of stopping just yet. And I was able to sit down with her in Doha at the World Cup final last year to have a chat about her career. But you're gonna have to wait for that.
Oh, Jamie, you big tease.
Well, it's worth waiting for. It's worth waiting for. And for now, I do have a little bonus clip. And in a future episode, we're dedicating especially to my chat with Kimberly Rhode. You'll hear all about her career in all its unedited glory. But for now, here is a bonus clip as promised. And I asked Kimberly what advice she has for any athlete going to compete at their first Olympic Games.
The advice I'd give to anyone who's going to their first Olympics would be to enjoy every minute of it. Try to do everything, but at the same time, remember that you're there to hopefully win the gold. And don't forget that goal in mind as you go and try to do everything. Because I think a lot of Olympians forget that, get overwhelmed with everything, and it does take a toll on their competition. But at the end of the day, it is incredible. It is a huge honor. Enjoy it. And congratulations to anyone who does make it.
Kim Rhode there. And as mentioned, you can hear the full interview in a future episode during the series. I promise you it will be worth the wait. But just a little bonus clip for you there to get you excited. Now, Martina, I do believe that you had the opportunity to throw some questions in the direction of none other than world champion Danka Bartekova. Now, for anyone new to the sport, what do they need to know about her and what did you discuss?
Well, other than what you just mentioned, she did win the world championship last year in Baku, but she is an also Olympic medalist back from London 2012, winning a bronze medal. She won multiple World Cups in her career, and she was a multiple European champion. So you can imagine, that was a great talk with Danka at the shooting range in Italy. She was completely geared up with her shotgun on her right shoulder. The 39-year-old has been shooting for most of her life, and she told us about growing up in the sport and the shock of her very first shot.
When I was younger, I remember going to the shooting range every now and then with my father, who was a shooter. He used to be a very, let's say, a hobby shooter. And I was there with my sister to cheer for him, to support him throughout the competitions. But when I had to go for my first training, which is something that I remember, I will remember for always, I went with my dad, with my uncle, who used to be a hunter too. They organized me a trainer, a coach, who was waiting for me to do a first couple of shots. And on the way, all of them were talking to me like, you have to expect a huge recoil. You have to expect that it's going to hurt. It's going to be very uncomfortable when you do a first shot. And when I actually put the cartridge inside the weapon, supervised by my coach, I remember being so stressed, being so anxious that when I triggered, of course I closed my eyes. I saw nothing, but I felt a huge satisfaction that it doesn't hurt. It's not very unpleasant. And actually, I quite enjoyed my first shot. So whenever someone asks me about my career, I always say shooting is a laugh on a first shot for me.
We also got to find out about her rich Olympic experience firsthand, from the shaky first Olympic Games to growing into a confident athlete and winning her medal at her favorite games, to the one that everyone will remember as the most unique one, the Tokyo Games.
Yes. I have competed at 4 Olympic Games, and I have to say all of them were a completely different experience for me. The first ones in Beijing, I was a rookie. I was a very young shooter, very inexperienced, and all I had to do was to participate as a world record holder, which happened a month before the Olympics. So I was so stressed. I wanted to justify my world record. I wanted to prove everyone that I'm worth it, that I was really, really stressed and I didn't do well. The second games for me were London. London was a completely different experience. I really enjoyed them. I was happy. I really wanted to have fun. I wanted to experience the best of the games, including the village, including a beautiful shooting range, including the hospitality of people. London was amazing for me. I remember sleeping between the rounds, really being kind of relaxed and enjoying every single moment. And of course, these games were very special for me because I got the bronze medal there. So those were the best games I will keep in my memory forever. Rio, of course, were the games where I was supposed to defend my Olympic medal, and honestly, I have gone through a very hard time mentally and as an athlete, but also as a person, struggling with a lot of pressure, struggling with a lack of confidence, and it all showed in a very very worst time, which is during the Olympic Games. So I didn't really enjoy those. But at the end of the day, everything is a learning process, and everything is a lecture that has to be done to make us feel stronger and more empowered and honestly more mature, which also happened for me in Tokyo. Tokyo was completely different games from everything that I have experienced before. It was quite sad. It was quite empty. It was quite stressful because for us athletes, we were really worried about the disease and about the coronavirus that was flying all around, and we were a little bit stressed. What if I will get positive and I will not be able to compete? What if it happens on a very last moment and I will not be able to demonstrate what I have been working on for the last 4 years? We were very thankful that the games happened. We were very thankful that even if it was a little bit different, we had a chance to experience the atmosphere of the games in the village. We had a chance to compete at the highest peak on our pathway as athletes. But at the same time, it was quite difficult to handle that struggle, to really cope with all those stressful situations, to manage that stress and anxiety. And at the end of the day, and even if I know that I was on the peak of my career and I was technically very well prepared, it was that mental aspect that I didn't really superate and dominate. And that made me shoot not as well as I wanted. So Tokyo was that kind of experience. I'm really looking forward to Paris. It's going to be hopefully more exciting. And it's going to be, let's say, games again.
And if you were ever questioning what goes on in an athlete's head during a shoot-off for a medal at the Olympics, Danka is here to tell you.
In that moment, when I knew that I was going to do a shoot-off with Martina, I'm standing there and I'm thinking of, okay, this is your moment. This is your time where you have to demonstrate. You have to show everyone, including yourself and foremost to yourself, that you're, you know, worth it. You have done everything to be there and be ready. And that's when I put all my stuff together and I get composed and started to feel stronger, started to feel more capable, and started to feel more confident. And that shoot off, I was on fire. I remember just going there, determined to win that medal. It was like, yeah, that medal is mine. I'm gonna do it. And that's probably one of the most important moments in my life, not only as a career as a shooter, but in my life, because I found the power and strength in myself to face a challenge, win it, and at the end of the day to go home with the medal. And that changed my life.
And finally, we jumped into the small joys of life.
Well, as a professional athlete, you don't have a lot of time to have your hobbies or other activities that you enjoy. For me, shooting is my pleasure and my joy. I found it at the shooting range. Of course, I do a lot of recovery stuff. I do a lot of other trainings. But what I really love is to hike, to go to the nature, get the source of energy there, spend some time with my family. And you know what? Every single thing that is considered as a normal stuff. I love cleaning my apartment. I love to cook dinners. I love to spend some time with my family. I love to have a dinner with my friends, playing cards and just watching a movie. And I love to spend time with people who are kind to my heart. So this is something that really makes me relax from being an athlete and gives me a lot of strength and power.
Danka Bartekova of Slovakia, world champion in the Skeet women's event. And as ever, she'll be one to watch this time when it comes to the Paris Games. And as mentioned, we have a lot more to come from Skeet in this series. We'll be dedicating an episode to the Skeet mixed team event, making its Olympic debut in Paris. And we'll have that Kimberly Rhode special that I keep on talking about. I'm getting obsessed. And we will also have an episode dedicated to the Skeet men's event. And I think we're going to have a little teaser clip for that now, aren't we, Martina?
Yes, we will, with USA's Vincent Hancock.
Another big name from the sport, it's fair to say, right?
Yes, also a three-time Olympic champion like Kim Rhode, which really shows you how strong the US team is. And they also have so many others as well, like Tania Vizi, to name another, who consistently shows up on the podiums last year. But back to Vincent. As we tease ahead to our future men's episode, I'm sure any fellow women watching will relate to this. Men struggle with multitasking.
What? It's a bit rude, but you are not holding back today, are you, Martina?
Actually, JB, I'm saying it's a good thing in this round, as Vincent Hancock explained to me how single-tasking comes in handy for his mindset during the finals.
Not really. I mean, I listen to music, but it's a different song every time, different artist, whatever it may be, just whatever's working that day, whatever pops up that I like, that's what I listen to. So typically I have a song playing through my head throughout the course of the competition, but even as I get older, that's even becoming less and less. Mm-hmm. And just simply because I don't need to try to block out all the other stuff as much as I used to, mm-hmm. because I have that process that trying to keep things simple. And I'm a guy, and typically guys can only think about one thing at a time. That's a good thing. It's a good thing to be simple, but a bad thing in a lot of other ways. But it is what it is. So I fill my mind with one thought that's progressively positive every time, and that helps me to have a positive outcome when I shoot the targets too.
Vincent Hancock talking to Martina there and explaining the merits of single tasking. We've got this. Oh, yes. So as another episode comes to an inevitable end on the road to Paris 2024, fear not, we have much more to come in the series.
We'll be back with another shooting discipline with more interviews to come from other best athletes in the world.
That's true, but until then, thank you for joining us and goodbye.
Goodbye.